Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Lost History of Liberalism, From Ancient Rome to the 21st Century, by Helena Rosenblatt. Narrated by Exy Sands. Introduction. It is never a waste of time to study the history of a word. Lucien Febvre, 1930. Liberalism is a basic and ubiquitous word in our vocabulary, but liberalism is also a highly contentious concept, one that triggers heated debate. Some see it as Western civilization's gift to mankind, others as the reason for its decline. A never-ending stream of books attacks or defends it, and hardly anyone can remain neutral. Critics accuse it of a long list of sins. They say that it destroys religion, the family, the community. It's morally lax and hedonistic, if not racist, sexist, and imperialist. Defenders are just as emphatic. They say that liberalism is responsible for all that is best about us, our ideas of fairness, social justice, freedom, and equality. The truth is, however, that we are muddled about what we mean by liberalism. People use the term in all sorts of different ways, often unwittingly, sometimes intentionally. They talk past each other, precluding any possibility of reasonable debate. It would be good to know what we are speaking about when we speak about liberalism. On that score, available histories of liberalism are seldom helpful. At first, they are often contradictory. According to one recent account, for example, liberalism originates in Christianity. However, according to another, liberalism originates in a battle against Christianity. Second, genealogies of liberalism ascribe its origins and development to a canon of great thinkers, but the cast often fluctuates. John Locke is frequently conscripted as a founding father, but some speak of Hobbes or Machiavelli instead. Still others of Plato or even Jesus Christ. Some include Adam Smith in a list of economists, others do not. None of these early thinkers, it should be known, considered themselves liberals or espoused anything called liberalism, since neither that word nor concept were available to them. And it goes without saying that our notions of liberalism will vary according to our choice of key thinkers and how we read them. Someone who begins with Machiavelli or Hobbes is likely to be a critic of liberalism, one who begins with Jesus Christ, a defender. In this book, I aim not to attack or defend liberalism, but to ascertain its meaning and trace its transformation over time. I clarify what the terms liberal and liberalism meant to the people who used them. I illuminate how liberals defined themselves and what they meant when they spoke about liberalism. This is a story that has never been told. Most scholars admit that there is a problem defining liberalism. They begin their work with an acknowledgement that it's a slippery or elusive term. What's strange, however, is that most of them then proceed to stipulate a personal definition and construct a history that supports it. This, I contend, is to argue backward, and in this book, I untangle our thoughts and set the story straight. Unless otherwise indicated, all translations are my own. There are additional puzzles and curiosities. In colloquial parlance in France and other parts of the world today, being liberal means favoring small government, while in America, it signifies favoring big government. American libertarians today claim that they are the true liberals. Somehow these people are all supposed to be part of the same liberal tradition. How and why did this happen? I offer an explanation. What I propose, then, is fundamentally a word history of liberalism. I feel certain that if we don't pay attention to the actual use of the word, the histories we tell will inevitably be different and even conflicting. They will also be constructed with little grounding in historical fact and marred by historical anachronism. My approach leads to some surprising discoveries. One is the centrality of France to the history of liberalism. We cannot speak of the concept's history without considering France and its successive revolutions. Nor can we ignore the fact that some of the most profound and influential thinkers in the history of liberalism were French. Another discovery is the importance of Germany, whose contributions to the history of liberalism are usually underplayed, if not completely ignored. The truth is that France invented liberalism in the early years of the 19th century, and Germany reconfigured it half a century later. America took possession of liberalism only in the early 20th century, and only then did it become an American political tradition. We will see that many individuals who are relatively unknown today made significant contributions to liberalism. German theologian Johann Salomo Semler invented religious liberalism. The French nobleman Charles de Montalembert may have invented the term liberal democracy, yet other key players contributed to the American journal The New Republic and thus imported and disseminated the concept in America. Liberals who are usually regarded as canonical, such as John Locke and John Stuart Mill, do play important roles in my story, but as we shall see, they were deeply immersed in the debates of their times. They conversed with and were inspired by French and German thinkers. They spoke directly to their contemporaries, not to us. They addressed the problems of their times, not ours. In addition, I highlight figures who unintentionally contributed to the history of liberalism, such as the two Napoleons, the Austrian Chancellor Clemens von Metternich, and many counter-revolutionary figures who forced liberals to hone and develop their beliefs. Finally, I elucidate what I think is a crucial fact that has been lost from history. At heart, most liberals were moralists. Their liberalism had nothing to do with the atomistic individualism we hear of today. They never spoke about rights without stressing duties. Most liberals believed that people had rights because they had duties, and most were deeply interested in questions of social justice. They always rejected the idea that a viable community could be constructed on the basis of self-interestedness alone. Ad infinitum, they warned of the dangers of selfishness. Liberals ceaselessly advocated generosity, moral probity, and civic values. This, of course, should not be taken to mean that they always practiced what they preached or lived up to their values. As I also endeavor to show, the idea that liberalism is an Anglo-American tradition concerned primarily with the protection of individual rights and interests is a very recent development in the history of liberalism. It is the product of the wars of the 20th century, and especially the fear of totalitarianism during the Cold War. For centuries before this, being liberal meant something very different. It meant being a giving and civic-minded citizen. It meant understanding one's connectedness to other citizens and acting in ways conducive to the common good. From the very beginning, liberals were virtually obsessed with the need for moral reform. They saw their project as an ethical one. This concern for moral reform helps to explain their constant concern with religion, and another aim of this book is to recalibrate our discussions to make room for this important fact. I show that religious ideas and controversies drove debates about liberalism from the very beginning, and that they polarized people into hostile camps. One of the earliest attacks on liberalism called it a religio-political heresy, setting the tone for the centuries to come. To this day, liberalism is obliged to defend itself against unrelenting charges of irreligion and immorality. The fact that liberals saw themselves as moral reformers does not mean that they were without sin. Much recent work has uncovered a dark side of liberalism. Scholars have exposed the elitism, sexism, racism, and imperialism of many liberals. How could an ideology dedicated to equal rights, they ask, have supported such heinous practices? I certainly do not deny the uglier sides of liberalism, but by placing liberal ideas in the context of their time, I tell a more nuanced and complex story. My treatment cannot pretend to be exhaustive. Although I reference liberalism in other parts of the world, I focus on France, Germany, Britain, and the United States. This choice may seem arbitrary or overly restrictive to some. Of course, other countries contributed to the history of liberalism. But I do believe that liberalism was born in Europe and spread outward from there. More specifically, liberalism owes its origins to the French Revolution, and wherever it migrated thereafter, it remained closely linked to and affected by political developments in France. I begin with a chapter on the prehistory of liberalism, starting with the Roman statesman Cicero and ending with the French nobleman the Marquis de Lafayette. In chapter 1, I explain what it meant to be liberal when its corresponding noun was liberality and the word liberalism did not yet exist. This deep history of the word liberal is good to know because self-titled liberals over the course of the following centuries continued to identify with this ancient and moral ideal, and dictionaries continued to define liberal in this traditional way. In the mid-20th century, the American philosopher John Dewey still insisted that liberalism stood for liberality and generosity, especially of mind and character. It had nothing to do, he said, with the gospel of individualism. The first chapter tells the story of how a word initially used to designate the ideal qualities of a Roman citizen was Christianized, democratized, socialized, and politicized, such that by the late 18th century, it could be employed to describe the American Constitution. The main part of the book then focuses on four key events in the intertwined histories of France and liberalism, namely the revolutions of 1789, 1830, 1848, and 1870, and the transatlantic debates that these revolutions engendered. The story of liberalism effectively begins in Chapter 2, which recounts the coining of the word and the controversies that surrounded it. Some of the topics discussed in this chapter are liberalism's relationship with republicanism, colonialism, laissez-faire, and feminism, all of which are themes that are developed further in the rest of the book. Perhaps the most important issue of all is liberalism's fraught relationship with religion, whose origins in the radical politics of the French Revolution are discussed here as well. Chapter 3 tells the story of liberalism's evolution from 1830 to the eve of the revolutions of 1848, paying close attention to the emergence of new political ideologies like socialism, on the one hand, and conservatism, on the other, and how they inflected liberalism as France careened toward yet another revolution. Chapter 4 deals with the perceived failure of liberalism in the upheavals of 1848 and how liberals sought to address this failure. They focused overwhelmingly on institutions like the family, religion, and Freemasonry in what they saw as an essentially moralizing and educational project. Chapter 5 turns to the topic of liberal governance, and with a focus on Napoleon III, Abraham Lincoln, William Gladstone, and Otto von Bismarck, recounts how their leadership engendered new ideas about the relationship between morals, liberalism, and democracy. The idea of a liberal democracy was born. Chapter 6 considers France's Fourth Revolution in 1870 and its repercussions. It describes the battles of the French Third Republic against the Catholic Church in the effort to create what Republicans called the most liberal educational system in the world. Chapter 7 recounts how a new liberalism, friendly to socialist ideas, was conceived toward the end of the 19th century, and how a classical or orthodox liberalism was conjured as a response. A great battle took place over which of these, the new or the old, was the true liberalism. Finally, Chapter 8 recounts how liberalism entered the American political vocabulary in the early 20th century and came to be seen as a uniquely American intellectual tradition, wrapped up also in the notion of American world hegemony. Policymakers now debated what exactly American liberalism meant in terms of foreign and domestic affairs. In the epilogue, I offer some suggestions as to why we have come to believe that liberalism is so fundamentally centered on private rights and individual choices. I discuss how the mid-20th century Americanization of liberalism came to eclipse the history recounted in this book, to the point that many of us today don't remember it at all. Chapter 1. What It Meant to Be Liberal. From Cicero to Lafayette. Liberal. 1. Not mean, not low in birth. 2. Becoming a gentleman. 3. Munificent, generous, bountiful. From A Dictionary of the English Language, 1768. Ask anyone today what liberalism means, and you'll get a variety of responses. It's a tradition of thought, a form of government, a value system, an attitude, or a frame of mind. Invariably, however, people will agree that liberalism is centrally concerned with the protection of individual rights and interests, and that governments are there to protect these. Individuals should have the maximum amount of freedom to make their own life choices and do as they wish. The truth is, however, that this focus on the individual and his or her interests is very recent. The word liberalism did not even exist until the early 19th century, and for hundreds of years prior to its birth, being liberal meant something very different. For almost 2,000 years, it meant demonstrating the virtues of a citizen, showing devotion to the common good, and respecting the importance of mutual connectedness. Republican Beginnings, a Moral and Civic Ideal. We could begin with the Roman statesman and author Marcus Tullius Cicero, 106 to 43 BC. One of the most widely read and cited authors in the history of Western thought, Cicero wrote eloquently about the importance of being liberal. The word stems from the Latin term liber, meaning both free and generous, and liberalis, befitting a freeborn person. The noun form corresponding to these two words was liberalitas, or liberality. First and foremost, being free in ancient Rome meant being a citizen and not a slave. It meant being free of the arbitrary will of a master or the domination of any man. The Romans thought that such a state of freedom was possible only under the rule of law and a republican constitution. Legal and political arrangements were necessary to ensure that the government focused on the common good, the res publica. Only under such conditions could an individual hope to be free. But to the ancient Romans, being free required more than a republican constitution. It also required citizens who practiced liberalitas, which referred to a noble and generous way of thinking and acting toward one's fellow citizens. Its opposite was selfishness, or what the Romans called slavishness, a way of thinking or acting that regarded only oneself, one's profits, and one's pleasures. In its broadest sense, liberalitas signified the moral and magnanimous attitude that the ancients believed was essential to the cohesion and smooth functioning of a free society. The English translation of the word is liberality. In On Duties, 44 BC, Cicero described liberalitas in a way that would resonate over the centuries. Liberalitas, Cicero wrote, was the very bond of human society. Selfishness was not only morally repugnant, but socially destructive. Mutual helpfulness was the key to civilization. It was the moral duty of free men to behave in a liberal way toward each other. And being liberal meant giving and receiving in a way that contributed to the common good. Men are not born for themselves alone, Cicero asserted. They are brought into being for the sake of others. Since we are not born for ourselves alone, since men were brought into being for the sake of men, that they might do good to one another, we ought to contribute our part to the common good. And by the interchange of kind offices, both in giving and receiving, alike by skill, by labor, and by the resources at our command, strengthen the social union of men among men. A century after Cicero, another famous and influential Roman philosopher, Lucius Annaeus Seneca, circa 4 BC to AD 65, elaborated on the principle of liberalitas in his book-length treatise on benefits, AD 63. Seneca took pains to explain how to give, receive, and return gifts, favors, and services in a way that was moral and thus constitutive of the social bond. Like Cicero, he believed that for a system based on exchange to work properly, a liberal attitude was needed in both givers and receivers. In other words, a selfless, generous, and grateful disposition. Borrowing from the Greek Stoic Chrysippus, circa 280 to 207 BC, Seneca offered an allegory of the virtue of liberality. The circular dance of the three graces, giving, receiving, and returning benefits. To ancient thinkers like Cicero and Seneca, liberality quite literally made the world go round and held it together. Being liberal was not easy. Cicero and Seneca expounded at length upon the principles that should inform giving and receiving. Like freedom itself, liberality required correct reasoning and moral fortitude, self-discipline, and command. It was clearly also an aristocratic ethos. It was designed by and for the free, wealthy, and well-connected men who were in position to give and receive benefits in ancient Rome. It was regarded as a particularly praiseworthy quality in the patrician class and among rulers, as is shown by many ancient inscriptions, official dedications, and texts. If liberalitas was a virtue appropriate to aristocrats and rulers, so was the liberal arts education that trained them for it and required considerable wealth and leisure time with which to study. Its primary purpose was not to teach students how to acquire wealth or to prepare them for a vocation, but to ready them for active and virtuous membership in society. It was meant to teach society's future leaders how to think properly and speak clearly in public, thus enabling them to participate effectively in civic life. Citizens were made, not born. Cicero often inserted that the liberal arts should teach humanitas, a humane attitude toward fellow citizens. The Greek historian and Roman citizen Plutarch, AD 46 to 120, wrote that a liberal education gave sustenance to a noble mind and led to moral improvement, disinterestedness, and public spirit in rulers. It was essential, in other words, to the inculcation of liberality. Medieval rearticulations. Liberality Christianized. As antiquity gave way to the Middle Ages, this ancient view of liberality was not entirely lost, but Christianized and further disseminated by early church fathers like St. Ambrose. St. Ambrose, who wrote a treatise modeled expressly on Cicero's On Duties, rearticulated Cicero's main ideas and principles. Any true community rested upon justice and goodwill, wrote Ambrose, and liberality and kindness were what held society together. Liberality during the Middle Ages was thus overlaid with Christian values such as love, compassion, and especially charity, values regarded as necessary not only in republics but in monarchies as well. God, Christians were told, was liberal in his mercy, just as Jesus was with his love. Christians should imitate God by loving and giving in return. Dictionaries from the Middle Ages on, whether French, German, or English, defined liberal as the quality of someone who likes to give, and liberality as the quality of giving or spending freely. Great medieval theologians such as Thomas Aquinas spread such notions in their writings. The medieval church continued to regard the liberal arts as the ideal educational program for society's leaders, frequently contrasted with the servile or mechanical arts that ministered to the baser needs of humankind, such as, for example, tailoring, weaving, and blacksmithing. The liberal arts were seen to develop intellectual and moral excellence. They prepared young men for active roles in the public sector and for service to the state. As in the ancient world, a liberal arts education was also a marker of status, setting the elite apart from the rest. Every Christian, rich or poor, was urged to be liberal, but liberality continued to be regarded as especially important in persons of a superior social station. Renaissance liberal arts. Liberality during the Renaissance continued to be an aristocratic or princely virtue. As one of many Renaissance texts explained, avarice was the sure sign of an ignoble and villainous spirit, while liberality was the proper virtue of the aristocrat. The scope of a liberal arts education was now broadened, and its prestige grew. The Italian humanist Pietro Paolo Vergerio, 1370-1445, an admirer of Cicero, rearticulated many classical ideas about education in his treatise on the noble character and liberal studies of youth. First published in 1402, it passed through 40 editions before 1600, becoming the most frequently copied and reprinted Renaissance pedagogical treatise. A liberal arts education, Vergerio explained, elevated those who received it above the unthinking crowd. It prepared them for positions of leadership and legitimized their claim to such positions. In the company of books, there was no greed. Young boys learned virtue and wisdom, the duties of citizenship. The focus on men in Vergerio's essay was certainly not accidental, since from its inception, a liberal education was conceived with young men and not women in mind. Its association with independence, public speaking, and leadership made it very hard to imagine its relevance and value to women. According to Spanish humanist Juan Luis Vives, 1493-1540, who wrote the major Renaissance work on female education, The Education of a Christian Woman, 1524, a book that was translated into English, Dutch, French, German, Spanish, and Italian, the learning of women should focus on their domestic functions and, most importantly, on keeping them chaste. While it was reasonable for a man to be equipped with the knowledge of many and varied subjects which will be of profit to himself and to the state, a woman was sufficiently instructed when she had been taught chastity, silence, and obedience. For this purpose, religious texts were deemed especially effective. This, however, does not mean that no Renaissance women received a liberal arts education. Evidence shows that some aristocratic women became highly educated. Several even wrote treatises defending the liberal arts, but the prejudice against liberal women helps to explain why, in those rare instances when it was granted, a woman's education was normally said to reflect her father's liberality rather than her own. It conferred honor and prestige on a Renaissance paterfamilias because it showed that he could afford such a luxury and need not worry about marrying off an overeducated daughter. The educated woman herself, however, was often ridiculed and vilified. That an advanced education rendered a woman masculine was a common refrain. That it made her a sexual predator was another. Even the word liberal was problematic when used to describe a woman because it often took on a sexual connotation. A liberal woman became sexually promiscuous. Reflecting long-held prejudices about women's supposed deviousness, sinfulness, and lasciviousness, a ballad from around 1500 warns that women are often liberal in secret. Regarding Renaissance boys, however, and especially those destined for positions of power and influence, both liberality and the liberal arts education that prepared them for it were held to be essential. The Dutch humanist priest and theologian Erasmus of Rotterdam, 1466-1536, referred to such well-educated boys as the seedbeds from which will appear senators, magistrates, doctors, abbots, bishops, popes, and emperors. His two treatises on education, The Education of a Christian Prince, 1516, and The Education of Children, 1529, recommended the liberal arts as second in importance only to Christian piety in the formation of wealthy and male individuals. Liberality, he made sure to clarify, meant more than just handing out gifts. It meant using your power for good. Among Renaissance artists, liberality continued to be symbolized by the ancient allegory of the three graces. The humanist polymath Leon Battiste Alberti, 1404 to 72, referenced Seneca when he explained that one of the sisters gives, another receives, and the third returns the favor, all of which degrees should be present in every act of perfect liberality. For Alberti, as for so many other Renaissance thinkers, the virtue of liberality was essential to any free and generous society. The politics of giving. Renaissance texts frequently exhorted elites to give careful thought to how they acquired and dispensed their wealth. Conduct books explained that liberality was a moral virtue that moderated men's desire and greed for money. Liberality was also about spending money usefully and not excessively. A liberal man used his wealth to support his household, friends, and relatives. He also helped those who had, due to no fault of their own, fallen into poverty. He did not spend money to show off. Indeed, knowing how to spend was proof of a person's value. Such a regard for appropriate spending was considered as an especially important quality in rulers. Baldassare Castiglioni's Book of the Courtier, 1528, the period's principal handbook of aristocratic values, stated that the good and wise prince ought to be full of liberality, and that God would reward him for this. But rulers were also advised not to be prodigal. Erasmus advised princes to practice moderation and discernment in their spending, and especially never to take from the deserving to give to the unworthy. With that particular blend of realism and idealism for which he became famous, Niccolò Machiavelli, 1469 to 1527, warned that a liberal prince should not spend beyond his means because that would only drain his resources and force him to raise taxes, which would oppress his people and provoke their hatred. Similarly, the French writer Michel Montaigne, 1533 to 1592, often regarded as the founder of modern skepticism, cautioned rulers that they should use justice and deliberation in their liberality, lest they pour the seed out of the bag. Well into the 17th and 18th centuries, elites and rulers were exhorted to be liberal but not indiscriminate in their giving. The French statesman and author Nicolas Faure, 1596 to 1646, made sure to differentiate liberality from promiscuous giving. A prince's generosity should always be guided by reason, prudence, and moderation. It should be extended in an orderly way to decent people and with due consideration to rank, birth, age, means, and reputation. Most importantly, a prince should never be perniciously liberal. That is, he should never give in a way that might exhaust his own funds. Other manuals show a similar concern to differentiate the lavish spending of the newly rich from the long-recognized virtue of liberality. The first edition of the Dictionary of the Académie Française, 1694, defined liberal as he who likes to give to people of merit. By its fourth edition, it had added, there is a big difference between a prodigal man and a liberal man. Protestant developments. The Protestant Reformation altered the Catholic meaning of liberality, but subtly, at least initially. Protestant Bibles helped spread the notion that liberality was not just a princely or aristocratic value, but a universal Christian imperative. Where earlier translations of the Bible rendered the word generous as noble or worthy to a prince, the New English and Puritan versions dropped the association with high status and substituted the word liberal. In the King James Version, 1604 to 11, the word appears several times, each time referring to generous giving, especially to the poor. Moreover, Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25, suggests that God rewards liberal behavior. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that watereth shall be watered also himself. A sermon delivered before the English King Charles I at Whitehall on April 15, 1628, suggests a subtle change of emphasis. John Donne, 1572 to 1631, a poet, lawyer, and cleric, began by reiterating the well-known principle that liberality was essential to kings, princes, and great persons. But then he added that even the population at large, that is, the people, should be liberal. reminding his congregation that Christ is a liberal God, Dunn declared that it was important for all Christians to give freely. And being liberal, Dunn added, was not only about sharing one's wealth, it was important to continuously find new ways to be liberal. Following Isaiah 32, "But the liberal deviseth liberal things, and by liberal things he shall stand." They should believe liberal purposes, accept liberal propositions, and apply them liberally. Dunn exhorted his congregation to show their liberality by divesting themselves of all ill feelings toward others. Being liberal was about sharing not simply one's gold, but also one's knowledge and wisdom. These, Dunn urged, should be communicated to others, even to the general public, and yet Dunn offered an important caveat. It was important to be liberal only to Christians, or one would be guilty of a spiritual prodigality, a transgression. The purpose behind the much-vaunted liberality, endlessly encouraged in moral treatises and sermons, was certainly not to redistribute property in any significant way or to disturb the religio-political order. Most Christian preachers, whether Catholic or Protestant, taught that one should give according to one's rank in society and not in ways that might endanger it. Matthew chapter 26, verse 11, states that ye have the poor always with you. And this was generally interpreted to mean that poverty was an unavoidable part of the social and political order. As one typical English courtesy book explained, God, in his wisdom, discerning that equality of conditions would breed confusion in the world, has ordered several states, designed some to poverty, others to riches. But liberality spread a sense of goodwill, benevolence, and Christian brotherhood. It sustained society and held it together. In some important ways, then, liberality in early modern Europe was meant to preserve the existing socio-political and religious order. As Cicero, Seneca, and their many disciples knew, gift-giving was a kind of social cement. Society functioned and cohered through the giving and receiving of benefits, in Seneca's terminology, that is, favors, honors, privileges, and services of various kinds. Christian charity and almsgiving also spread a sense of community and goodwill. Finally, the display of liberality enhanced a person's dignity and standing in society. American exceptionalism and the liberal tradition. And yet, Christian liberality, especially in its Puritan manifestations, could and did lead to potentially disruptive positions. This can be seen in the famous City Upon a Hill sermon delivered by Puritan preacher John Winthrop, 1587 to 1649, upon his arrival at the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1630. Still on board the ship Arabella, Winthrop declared that the very unusual times through which his Puritan community was living demanded extraordinary liberality from them. Under the very difficult circumstances they were facing, there was no such thing, he made a point of saying, as being over-liberal. Extraordinary liberality was their only recipe for survival. Liberality was now demanded of the whole community toward each other. They must think of the public good before themselves. In the years to come, this sermon would often be invoked to support the idea of American exceptionalism, whose liberal founding principles were a beacon to the world. The colonists should bear one another's burdens and view themselves as a company of Christ, bound together by love. Winthrop's advocacy of extraordinary liberality was certainly unusual in the 17th century. More common were exhortations to a moderate, discriminating, and aristocratic liberality, less threatening to the aristocratic and monarchical status quo. Humans were, in the words of the Dutch natural law theorist Hugo Grotius, 1583 to 1645, sociable and reasonable creatures by nature. They were both able and morally obligated to act in a liberal way toward one another. Cicero's On Duties was published in 14 English and many more Latin editions between 1534 and 1699. It was a basic text at schools like Westminster and Eton and at various Cambridge and Oxford colleges. Between 1678 and 1700, a shortened version of Seneca's On Benefits was also edited. Young boys in elite institutions across Europe were taught that society depended on their liberality, that is, on their generosity, moral probity, and civic values. Thus, by the mid-17th century, Europeans had been calling liberality a necessary virtue for more than 2,000 years. If ever there was a liberal tradition, this was it. Thomas Hobbes and John Locke on liberality. Today, Thomas Hobbes, 1588 to 1679, and John Locke, 1632 to 1704, are often regarded as founding fathers of liberalism. This is curious, however, because they never used the word and had radically different perspectives on liberality. Hobbes rejected the liberal tradition described above root and branch. Men, he declared, were naturally violent and selfish. Poor, nasty, and brutish, they were driven by mutual fear. War was their natural condition. Human beings, Hobbes claimed, were unable to govern themselves or live peacefully together without a powerful leader to keep them all in awe and to direct their actions to the common benefit. A perpetual war of every man against his neighbor could be avoided only by a strong and undivided government in the hands of an absolute monarch. Liberality played no discernible role in Hobbes' narrative. Natural law philosophers, moralists, and religious thinkers across Europe reacted in horror to Hobbes' propositions, accusing him of atheism and immorality. Tract after tract presented a more optimistic view of man and reaffirmed the reality and central importance to society of liberality, often calling on the authority of Cicero to do so. Men were both capable and duty-bound to practice liberality. Human beings had been endowed by God to express goodness toward others. Despite Hobbes' animadversions, the belief in the power of liberality survived and even prospered. In France, however, an influential group of Catholic moralists, heavily influenced by Jansenism, developed views very similar to those of Hobbes. Blaise Pascal, François de la Rochefoucauld, Pierre Nicole, and Jacques Esprit all subscribed to a very pessimistic view of human nature. Man was, in the words of Pascal, a vile and abject creature, whose overriding drive was always self-love. Pierre Nicole, another eminent French moralist in the Jansenist tradition, asserted that man loved himself without limits or measure, and that this rendered him violent, unjust, and cruel. Without an absolute monarchy to contain them, men would be in a perpetual state of war with each other. Fear and cupidity were what held society together. For the French Jansenists, as for Hobbes, when men traded services and civilities with one another, it was not due to any innate capacity to practice liberality, but always out of self-interest. Curiously, however, the Jansenists did not deny the importance of liberality. What they did instead was to describe liberality as a false but nevertheless necessary virtue. In their minds, it was something akin to politeness, a way that men hid their natural sinfulness. In his Falsity of Human Virtues of 1678, Jacques Esprit summed up the Jansenists' way of thinking when he said that the most human beings could ever do was to pass themselves off as liberal. It is noteworthy, however, that several of these Jansenist thinkers, and Nicole in particular, came to the conclusion that even such hypocrisy was necessary for human society to function. Liberality need not be sincere for society to cohere. Other philosophers, theologians, and writers either ignored or rejected this pessimism about human nature and its obsession with sinful motives and hypocrisy. One such philosopher was John Locke. Locke translated some of Nicole's essays and, in the process, accentuated the positive. "Love and respect are the bonds of society," he wrote, "and necessary to its preservation. Society depended on the traffic of kindness. Without it, society could hardly hold together." The idea that human beings were naturally capable and duty-bound to behave liberally toward each other was reiterated in almost everything Locke wrote. In his most influential Essay Concerning Human Understanding, 1689, he argued against orthodox notions of original sin and reigning epistemological theories by claiming that moral ideas were learned, not inborn. Therefore, all human beings could and should be taught the moral principles by which to lead their lives. In The Reasonableness of Christianity, 1695, Locke stressed the importance for Christians to engage in good works. Jesus commanded loving our enemies, doing good to those that hate us, blessing those that curse us, praying for those that despitefully use us, patience and meekness under injuries, forgiveness, liberality, compassion. Such ideas about the capacity and duty of human beings to be liberal also formed the substratum to Locke's Two Treatises of Government, 1690, in which he again recognized that men had obligations toward their fellows, including, in particular, the duty to contribute to the preservation of mankind. In clear opposition to Hobbes, Locke argued that it was in large part because men could behave ethically that they did not need an absolute monarch to rule them. Men in a state of nature were capable of knowing and following a moral law. In other words, it was precisely because men were capable of liberality that they could live under a limited constitutional monarchy characterized by a significant amount of self-government. Locke contributed in other ways to the liberal tradition we are recounting here. He wrote, for example, about the importance of teaching children liberality. In Some Thoughts Concerning Education, 1693, he enumerated a few of the most fundamental moral principles that he believed children must learn. They should be taught to be kind, liberal, and civil to others. Selfishness should be weeded out and the contrary quality implanted. Children should learn to part with what they have easily and freely to their friends. Such an education, said Locke's disciple and friend, the third Earl of Shaftesbury, 1671 to 1731, formed a generous temper and disposition, well-regulated appetites, and worthy inclinations. The Scottish theologian George Turnbull, 1698 to 1748, elaborated further on these principles in his widely read Observations on Liberal Education in All Its Branches, 1742. The purpose of a liberal education, he explained, was to train young boys to become worthy members of society. For this, it was necessary to teach them self-mastership and what Turnbull called inward liberty, by which he meant the overcoming of selfishness and vice. Young men had to be trained to love the right things, justice, truth, and the greater good of mankind. This is what it meant to humanize the mind and wake the generous affections. Enlightenment liberality. Today, some say that liberalism owes its origins to the Enlightenment, but once again, it is important to know that no one spoke of liberalism during the 18th century. The word and concept had not yet been conceived. However, liberality continued to be championed and, thanks to new forms of communication, disseminated like never before. Enlightenment liberality remained a virtue mainly associated with noble birth and aristocratic elites. Dr. Johnson's Dictionary of the English Language defined the word liberal as not mean, not low in birth, and becoming a gentleman. As before, it was widely assumed that only a select few would have access to the education that would form the generous, kindly temper of such a liberal man. John Locke wrote his educational treatise with the sons of gentlemen in mind, and the moral ethos he promoted was aristocratic. He delivered lectures on morality for the sons of gentlemen, organized a social club for gentlemen, and signed his works John Locke, Gent. According to Shaftesbury, an appropriate education for gentlemen should form a genteel and liberal character, suitable to the natural leaders of society, but not the vulgar. Turnbull addressed his widely read observations to the young sons of nobility and gentry. The purpose of a liberal education was to instill in the minds of young boys of good breeding a truly liberal and manly temper. References to gentlemen and manliness are common in 18th century texts on the virtues of a liberal education. Hardly anyone at the time thought it was a good idea to enlarge the minds of girls. François Fénelon's On the Education of Girls, 1687, succinctly summarized the reigning consensus. Written at the invitation of the Duke and Duchess de Beauvais, who had 9 daughters, it was quickly translated into English and German and was frequently reissued during the 18th and 19th centuries, making it one of the most popular education manuals of the time. The learning of girls, Fénelon wrote, should be kept within narrow bounds. It was important to restrain their minds as much as possible, keeping them focused on their domestic duties, that is, managing a household, making a husband happy, and raising children. Humanistic study should explicitly be withheld from women because it might turn their heads. 100 years later, an enlightened reformer like Adam Smith, 1723 to 1790, still thought it commendable that the girls of his time were taught only what was useful for them to know and nothing else. Every element of their education should prepare them for their predestined domestic roles, either to improve the natural attractions of their person or to form their mind to reserve, to modesty, to chastity, and to economy, to render them both likely to become the mistresses of a family and to behave properly when they have become such. By Smith's time, biomedical theories about women's nature were reinforcing traditional notions about what constituted a suitable education for women by suggesting that sustained intellectual labor was harmful to their health. Meanwhile, however, the shaping of liberal male minds was even more prized during the Enlightenment. Smith himself benefited from a liberal arts education, which prepared him well for university studies and eventually his position as professor of moral philosophy at the University of Glasgow. There, Smith studied moral philosophy under Francis Hutcheson, 1694 to 1746, whose teachings stress the importance of liberality, that is, of engaging in acts of kindness to others. Hutchison's inaugural lecture at Glasgow was on the natural fellowship of mankind. Explicitly refuting the egoistic philosophy of Hobbes, Hutchison asserted that human beings were endowed with a moral sense, which made them capable of seeing the virtue of compassionate, generous, and benevolent affections and encouraged them to behave accordingly. The culture of our minds, he taught, principally consists in forming just opinions about our duty, and constantly keeping in mind the common interest was one of the most important duties of all. To learn about these duties, Hutchison recommended that students read Cicero, Locke, and Shaftesbury. A liberal disposition was often commingled with condescension, if not outright disdain, for the poor. Certainly, this was the case in France, where well into the 18th century, liberality remained closely identified with noble status. As the Catholic bishop and preacher Jean-Baptiste Massillon, 1663 to 1742, explained in one of his famous sermons, the lower classes were less capable of liberality, while generosity, elevated sentiments, and sensitivity to the unfortunate were marks of nobility. John Locke made similar observations. A liberal arts education, he said, was not intended for the greatest part of mankind who are given up to labor and enslaved to the necessity of their mean condition. He wrote that poor children from the age of 3 could be sent out to work. As an agent of English colonialism, Locke also helped author texts that supported slavery. Magazines, treatises, and dictionaries well into the 19th century disseminated such ideas. They described a liberal arts education as fit for gentlemen and scholars, while an education in the mechanic trades and handicrafts was appropriate for meaner people, destined for servile occupations. In America, too, the more established gentry tended to regard the common people as naturally narrow-minded and bigoted. To Nathaniel Greene, 1742 to 1786, one of George Washington's generals, the great body of the people was always contracted, selfish, and illiberal. They should never be confused with gentlemen who had more noble natures. Washington himself is known to have spoken of the grazing multitude and John Adams of the common herd of mankind. Common persons, he wrote, have no idea of learning, eloquence, and genius. Their vulgar, rustic imaginations were easily led astray. Enlightenment transformations. Although the Enlightenment carried forward the importance of liberality, it also introduced new uses of the term. Its scope was expanded and, in some senses, democratized. It now became possible to speak not only of liberal individuals, but of liberal sentiments, ideas, and ways of thinking. Such sentiments, ideas, and ways of thinking can manifest themselves in larger circles of people, writers and scholars, preachers and officials, the educated public, and even an entire generation. While a liberal arts education was still regarded as an important way to inculcate liberality in boys of the elite, Enlightenment philosophies began thinking that one could learn to be liberal in other settings, too. A person might acquire liberality in any number of social venues, such as gentlemen's clubs, Masonic lodges, salons, and art exhibitions, all of which were proliferating at the time. Thus, an 18th-century gentleman's club in London described its purpose as being the mutual improvement by liberal conversation and rational inquiry. The club saw itself as disseminating throughout the country a liberality of spirit that its members believed was conducive to progress. Apparently, one could now become liberal by thinking and speaking freely to others. And such liberality would lead to the improvement of all of society. The Scottish historian William Robertson, 1721 to 1793, took obvious pleasure in reporting the diffusion of liberality. Over the course of history, he wrote, liberal sentiments were growing and being disseminated throughout Europe. They were causing the manners of Europeans to become more gentle, refined, and civilized. Liberal tenets, an 18th-century German thinker proffered, were principles in sync with the reasonable, moral, and progressive forces in history. Many others agreed. George Washington celebrated the growing liberality of sentiment of his age, certain that it was having ameliorating influence on mankind. One of the most important ways that liberality was improving mankind was by fostering religious toleration. This was something new. Christian arguments going back at least as far as St. Augustine, 354 to 430, held that the punishment of heretics was an act of charity since it helped to save them in the eyes of God and prevented society from descending into chaos. While the French court preacher Jacques-Bénigne Bossuet, 1627 to 1704, urged his king to be liberal and think great thoughts for the good of mankind, He saw no contradiction in also commending the king for his escalating persecution of French Protestants, which included the forcible conversion, imprisonment, and exile of hundreds of thousands of French men and women. There is no evidence that he, nor anyone else at the time, made a connection between the virtue of liberality and the idea of religious toleration. John Locke appears to have been the first to make that connection. Alarmed by Louis XIV's mounting persecution of Protestants in France, and worried also about continuing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.